So hope you all are doing great. So today we'll be presenting on a topic called faster big data analytics by maneuvering Apache Carbon Data's indexes. Okay, so before diving in, let me introduce myself and my colleague. So my name is Akash, and I have Kunal Kapoor. So we are both Carbon Data Committer and PMC, and basically we are part of Bangalore Cloud and AI branch of Huawei. Let's get started. Okay, so as our the topic title says that so we will be talking mainly about the indexes supported in Carbon Data, so which will basically help us in improving the query performance. Okay, so let's just go through the agenda. So what we'll be talking about in this presentation today. Okay, so in this, first we will start with what is Carbon Data and why we need to use Carbon Data, and what are the types of indexes supported in Carbon Data, and then we will see the index caching mechanism and distributed index cache server, okay, so which is a key feature of Carbon Data, and then we will see some performance comparisons with Carbon Data's indexes. Okay, so now let's get started. What is Carbon Data here? So basically, Carbon Data is an indexed columnar format for faster analytics on big data platform. So basically, Carbon Data support is it is supported on different storage systems like Hadoop HDFS, Amazon S3, then Huawei OVS store, and then Alluxio and some other custom storage implementations also. And Carbon Data is supported on different query processing engines like Apache Spark, Flink, the Presto SQL, Presto DB, Hive, etc. So basically, Carbon Data is a one-stop solution for all your history and real-time data storage and query processing. It is famous, and it is faster because of its index support and query optimizations, predicate pushdown, and some other key features. So okay, now let's understand why we need to use Carbon and what are the different use cases or the features supported by Carbon Data. Let's understand why we need to use Carbon Data. Okay, so the first and the basic need for any file format is a faster query execution. So first use case is the faster query execution. Then how we are faster is first of all, it's a columnar format. Okay, and since we support multi-level indexes, and thanks to the finer pruning provided by the Carbon Data, and the query processing is on the dictionary encoded values, like the on the features like local dictionary. Okay, so because of that, we have a faster pruning, which will results to faster query execution. Okay, and Carbon Data is ACID compliant, so basically it works on snapshot isolation, and there are no any intermediate data is stored on any failures on the system. Okay, and it supports various data operations like insert, update, delete, and it support for streaming scenarios, and it support multiple indexes, as I said before. The most interesting feature is a multi-level index. So as our the presentation says, so we will be speaking more about indexes supporting Carbon Data and its usage in the upcoming slides. So here we'll just see in the high level. So basically, Carbon Data supports min-max index, and it supports full text search using the Lucene index, and it also supports Bloom filter quality queries, Bloom filters. Okay, and Carbon Data also supports a materialized view for faster OLAP queries, and it supports a time series query with different granularities. Okay, so next thing is the high scalability. Okay, so due to its separation of storage and the processing, so it is highly scalable, and it is suitable for the cloud scenarios, and many customers are already taking or leveraging the advantage of Carbon Data in cloud. So the one more major feature important key feature supported by Carbon is insert, update, delete, and merge support. Okay, so it is the insert, update, and delete are very faster because Carbon Data does not operate on, or basically does not rewrite the complete data for every incoming update or delete. Okay, so basically it operates on the delta files or the incremental data, or what we can say that if a row is updated, and we'll only operate on the delta data here. So which makes it very faster when it comes to the data mutation operations like update and delete. And we support the merge operations for CDC scenarios. And Carbon Alta also supports the streaming scenarios. So what it does is it supports both real-time query analysis and the history data analysis on the same table, and makes it very easy. It supports a handoff, so which is nothing but converting the data to the columnar format and storing for the further analysis. Okay, and even streaming tables also supports the different indexes, and once the handoff happens, it updates all the indexes present on that table, particular table. Okay, so now let's go and see what are the different types of indexes supported in Carbon Data. So due to time constraint, I will not be going through all the indexes supported by Carbon. So we'll be going through mainly these four indexes. So which are min-max index, the secondary index, metallized view, and geospatial index. Okay, so let's deep dive into each of the indexes and understand what and how does it help us. Let's start the first index, so which is a min-max index. So you know, as the name suggests, so it is very simple to understand that in this we'll be storing the min-max of the columns. Okay, so basically it's a collection of min-max metadata for all of the columns in the table. Okay, as simple as that. So now where we store this min-max metadata? Okay, so Carbon Data table or each batch of data will generate a file called as Carbon Merge Index, which will contain index files. Okay, so that index file will have a footer, and that footer will contain all the metadata of all the Carbon Data files present in that batch of data or that segment of data. Okay, so now this min-max index is a default index for pruning. Okay, so basically user need not create a special or you know, you need not give any special properties to create this index. So this is by default, Carbon Data creates this index when a batch of data is written into table, and that index will be used for pruning or skipping of the Carbon Data files when the query comes in, or basically for scanning. Okay, so this is a default index. And these min-max indexes, basically Carbon Data stores in four levels of storage. Okay, so first is at a segment level, so which is a very high level of data segregation, and then next comes the block level. So when I say block or file, so here we mean that one Carbon Data file. Okay, so we store a data in the min-max data in the Carbon Data file, and then the next level of data granularity is blocklet level, so which will be present within each Carbon Data file, and then within each blocklet we'll have multiple pages, and we'll store min-max at page level also. So we will use all these metadata present in all the different levels of data, different levels of data segregation, and we will use all this information for very fine pruning, so which will help us to skip so many data and improve the performance of our query. Now let's see the second index, which is a secondary index. Okay, so before getting into what is secondary index, or what are the usages and other stuff, so let's go through some of the pain points of our customers, so which led us to creation of secondary index feature in Carbon Data. Okay, so first point was, so our customers were having a lot of high cardinality columns, and they were facing slower point query performance on these columns. Okay, and that was basically when we identified, so that was happening because it was scanning, there were a lot of false positive blocks, means, so it was scanning a lot of Carbon Data files unnecessarily, so which was obviously leading to expensive IO, so in turn the result will be slower query performance. Okay, so this was their major points. So with these all points, to counter these problems, so we came up with the idea of secondary index. So basically, what is secondary index? So secondary index is a child table created on an index column of parent table. Okay, so as simple as that. So we'll just create a table, which is a child table on a column called as index column. So that is basically a column present in a table. Okay. So what we store in secondary index. Okay. So it stores the location of that specific index column data till block rate level. Okay. So by this we can, you know, directly we can understand that. So since we're storing the block rate level, it is nothing but storing address of each data. So that, so whenever a query happens, right? So we will be directly knowing that, okay, I just need to scan these block rates, right? So that we'll be avoiding a lot of false positives, which will make our query faster and less IO, right? Because we'll be scanning a less number of block rates. Okay. So, and it works as a runtime filter. Okay. So when I say runtime filter, what it means is user need not worry about what secondary index tables to select for his query to be faster, right? So when user queries, he no need to worry about any indexes created on that table. So Carbon Data Optimizer is intelligent enough to search for different indexes and get a most reliable index based on the filter condition. Okay. And then it will transform that filter so that it will scan the secondary index table, get all the required block rates to scan, and then inform the parent table that you just scan only these block rates. Okay, so this is as simple as that. And we can say when we need to use, we can ask for ourselves when we need to use a secondary index. So basically, it is ideal for filter queries on least sorted columns, right? So it is for simple reason that when your data is least sorted, then it is obvious that we will end up in having a lot of false positives when we do the pruning with min-max, right? So that's why we need to use the second index on least sorted columns. Now we have understood the second index. So let's go and see the a small demo where we will see how to use a second index with just a small example.
So now we have understood what is second index and what are the use cases for it. So now let's try out some examples and understand how to use SI. So now here, as you can see, so I have created a couple of tables prior to this. So let's go and create some secondary indexes on this and let's see it. So as we can see this from the show segments command, a batch of data is loaded into fact table. So, and we can see the status as success. Okay. So now on this data, we can create a secondary index. Okay, so now I have created a secondary index called SI index on table fact table. And then the column, basically the index column is department name. So now as data is already being loaded into the parent table, so basically the SI created on this should be refreshed with that data. So now let's go and check whether data is being loaded on secondary index table or not. So as we can see here also a batch of data has been loaded. Okay. So here we can see that the status is success. Okay. So now let's go and fire some queries to see how SI will be used. So now here, if you see the query, so I will be having some two projection columns and I am having a filter on the index column. So basically on this column, I have created a secondary index. So let's go and fire this query. Okay, so now we got the results, but we don't know whether the query is using the secondary index we have created or not. So how to check that? So we can go and explain this query. So as from the explain the Spark plan, we can see that in the physical plan, so basically, we can see that the SI index, which we created, it is getting scanned. And in the physical planning, we are adding a node called broadcast SI filter push join, which will basically select the position reference as explained in this slide. And it will add the selected blocklets and it will tell the parent table to scan only those blocklets.
Now we will start with the materialized view, which is a third index in this presentation. So what is materialized view? So, and I think everybody knows what is materialized view. So now materialized view is a pre-computed carbon data table to provide an increased performance and efficiency. So basically, we just it's a generalized, you know, view where we can store. It can be an pre-aggregated data, or it can be a filtered data, or it can be just a column data, you know, as per the user needs. So basically, we just store pre-computed results in a Carbon data table. Now here MV supports incremental refresh. Okay, so that it supports both in online and offline mode. Okay, so maybe let's just see with an example of incremental refresh, which is present on materialized view. Okay, so let's assume that we have a carbon data table, and let's assume we have three batches of data coming in. Okay, so after three batches of data, let's assume that user creates a materialized view. Okay, so once a materialized view is created, so let's assume that MV is created with some pre-aggregation. Okay, so we need a pre-aggregated data in MV. So in this case, what happens? The three batches of data, right? So in this case, segment 0, segment 1, and segment 2. So it will combine all these data, it will do the aggregation and store in a segment 0 of MV table. Okay, so basically MV is also a carbon table, which is a child table to the parent table. So it's very simple. So whatever asset capabilities applied to our carbon table apply also to MV table here. Okay, so now let's assume that we have some incoming data. Okay, so let's assume two batches of data comes here, which is S3 and S4. So now after this, user can update these indexes. So in this case, so MV is not completely rebuilt, right? So because complete refresh will always take a lot of time. So in this case, what we do, we just take the incremental data, which is S3 and S4, and then it will store in a segment called S1 in MV. Okay. So now we'll see in materialized view can be beneficial in what and all ways. Okay. So main thing is, if you're storing the pre-aggregated data here, so main advantage here is the reduction in the query execution time, basically for the aggregated query, right? So since we'll be directly querying from the MV table, so that query execution time will be reduced drastically. And user can create multiple materialized view, and carbon data is intelligent enough to select the most efficient materialized view and fetch the data for faster queries. Materialized view also supports time series queries for different granularities, like second, hour, minute, week, month, year, etc. Okay, and it also supports a query rollup across the granularity. So now let's see with an example. So what is a create? I mean, what is a syntax for create, and how we do in carbon data? So materialized view can be created using a DDL called create materialized view, and user can provide the query on which he needs to create MV. So in this case, we are creating a MV called MV, and the query is, query contains a join on a table with aggregation of sum, and we have group by on the two columns. Okay, so now here basically what happens is, the two tables, right, T1 and T2, are scanned, and the join operation is performed with aggregations of sum, and then the aggregated data is stored in the materialized view called MV in this case. Okay, so let's assume that user does a query. So if you see this query, so user is having a one aggregation of sum, and he is having a filter also in this case, right? So now in this case, what happens? So carbon data optimizer will identify the materialized view on the table T1 and T2, and then it will do a query plan matching of user query and the materialized view query on which we created. In this case, we have MV, so it will create a plan of MV and the user query, and it will do the matching. So if there is a matching, perfect match, so then what we do is, we will rewrite this user query. And then if you see the rewritten query, so here we will be scanning on MV rather than, you know, T1 and T2, where a join happens, right? So if you see this, so this is just directly scanning already joined data, right, on a metallized view called MV. So in this case, we just need to apply the filter and we just need to apply the aggregation of one column, right? So the query is rewritten like this and the data is selected from metallized view, okay? So now this we will just go through a small demo and see how to create MVs and how to use MV with the queries and how to verify MV using the plan of the query. Okay, so let's go through the demo.
Now we understood what are materialized view in Karban data and how we do the query planning and rewriting. So let's go out and let's try out some examples how to create MV and how to use it and how to verify basically. Okay, so now as we can see here, I have loaded a couple of tables. So fact table one and fact table two, and I already loaded data into that. Okay, so now let's go and create a materialized view with a join query, which has some aggregation and we have some group by columns there. Okay, so let's go and create that. Okay, so here, as we can see from query, so we have aggregations, which is some, and we have some group by columns. Okay, and this is a join query. So now the materialized view is being created and the aggregated data, which is basically the join data of fact table one and fact table two, are loaded into materialized view. Okay, so now let's not go and query the materialized view directly. So we can directly see how MV is being used in Karban when we do the select query. So now here, if you see, I have, this is not exactly the same query as the MV query here. Okay, so here I will be doing a join and I have the filter here. Okay, so I am adding a filter called on employee name column. Okay, so now here we got the results, but again here we are not sure that whether the data is being fetched from the parent tables by doing the actual join operation or it is getting from the materialized view. Okay, so how to verify that? So let's go and verify using the plan. Okay, so here we will just go and see explain command. Okay, so after the explain command, if you see in the logical plan and the analyze logical plan, we can still see the fact tables. Okay, so if you see the optimized logical plan, we are not seeing the fact tables here. That is because during optimization, so what Karban optimizer does is it will do the plan matching of user query, okay, and the query from which we created materialized view. And then if the plan is matched, okay, then it will do the query rewrite as I explained before, and then it will change the plan. And then if you see the physical plan here, we will be scanning directly from the materialized view instead of, you know, actual getting the data from the fact tables and then doing the join.
So now let's see the last index, geospatial index. So before getting into what is geospatial index in Karban, so let's understand the key pain points of our customers. Okay, so before supporting geospatial, so when user was having the geospatial data, so they will be having the longitude and latitude columns. Okay, so when we treat these columns independently and sort,
let's go back and see the other indexes. What Karban data
is linearized and data is not ordered by spatial proximity. Okay, so due to this problem, the range queries, right, so which involved the, which we were querying the polygon regions or any spatial region, so it was leading to more IO, right? So in turn, the query response was very slow for the geo data here, right? So due to all these problems, so we came up with a geospatial index support in Karban data, and now let's see how all these pain points are addressed with geospatial. Okay, so in this case, so what we do is we don't treat longitude and latitude columns as two different columns. So what we do is we create an additional column, okay, that will call, that is called as geo index column. Okay, so that index column is basically generated with help of longitude and latitude data. Okay, so basically the corresponding latitude and longitude data. Okay, so we add this new geo index column and we do the sorting based on this index column. So which will resolve our spatial proximity problem. Okay, so with this, that after the 2-3 the problems we have discussed with the customer pain points, so those are solved with this now. And now Carbon Data supports the different type of queries like polygon queries. It also supports intersection and union of polygon queries, and it supports polyline queries also. Okay, to query the range of latitude and longitude points, and to query a spatial region with latitude and longitude input. Okay, so currently Carbon Data is supporting GeoHash for the spatial index, and it supports a pluggable interface for custom geo indexing algorithm. Okay, so as of now, Carbon is supporting GeoHash, as I said. And if any user wants some other indexing algorithms, right? So he can just plug his algorithm into Carbon Data, and he can use that indexing for their use cases, specific use cases. So this pluggable interface is not only limited to geo. So Carbon Data supports a pluggable interface, so where any kind of external index can be plugged in with Carbon Data, and we can leverage the benefit of those specific indexes. Okay, so now we discussed the geospatial. So let's just go and see with an example. So how to create geospatial index and how to do the queries with polygon and polyline queries with the different UDF supported in Carbon. So let's go and see a small demo.
Okay, now we understood what is a geospatial index and how we support in Carbon, what are the pain points and all. So now let's go and create a geospatial table, a geospatial index table, and then we'll fire a query to see how we support it. Okay, so let's go and create a table here. Okay, so as you can see here, so we are creating a normal Carbon table. So only difference between the normal create Carbon table and specific to geospatial support is, so in the table properties, we need to mention the spatial index. Okay, so what is index? So here we are calling as a my geo hash, and the geo hash type is the index type is geo hash here. And the source columns are basically the latitude and the longitude columns for this geospatial index here, and the other required properties we need to give. And here, as you can see, I am mentioning a class geohash index. So this is the implementation of index creation here. So as I said earlier, so here we are supporting a pluggable interface to support different indexing algorithms. Okay, so let's go and create this table. So now table is created. So now let's go and load some geospatial data here. Okay, so now the data is loaded into the table. So now let's go and fire a query to query a specific region. Okay, so now Carbon supports in polygon UDF. Okay, so which takes a list of latitude and longitude points. Okay, so let's go and fire that. So here, if you see, I am using in polygon UDF, which will take a series of points here. So these points are basically the set of latitude and longitude points. So here, if you see, the first point and the last point are same. So this is how it forms a closed region on which we are going to query, and we are going to get the data in that region. Okay, so let's go and fire that query. So here we got the output here. Okay, so we basically here we are selecting latitude and longitude columns for just example. Okay, so in the similar way, we support in polygon range list UDF, so which basically takes multiple polygons, and it can help to provide intersection or the union of polygon regions, geospatial regions. Okay, so in the similar way, we will be supporting in polyline UDF to support the polyline queries. So due to time constraint, I am not going to show all the UDF. So we can go and check the Carbon Data website or documentation for further usage. Okay, so this is end. This will end our the Carbon indexes support. So now let's go and learn about the Carbon indexing mechanism and how we store the indexes and the other index server and other stuff. Okay, so now I will welcome my colleague Kunal to explain and take you further.
So now that we have understood the various types of indexes that Carbon Data uses for pruning acceleration, let us try to understand the techniques that Carbon Data uses to manage the index metadata. So before going into the execution modes, as discussed earlier, you already know that index file stores all the min-max of the columns. Therefore, for each query, the get splits phase will ask the LRU for the cache. If the cache is not found, then the index file is read and it is the min-max objects are loaded back into the cache. Okay, so coming back to the execution modes, there are two types of caching mechanisms in Carbon Data. One is the driver mode, which is the default mode. The second is the distributed mode. We'll go through both of them individually and get to know the pros and cons for each. First mode is the driver mode. So as the name suggests, we can guess that all the min-max that will be cached in the driver. So driver, by driver here, I mean it can be either Spark driver or the Presto coordinator or Hive driver, anything, right? So let us talk about the pros of the driver mode. So the point number one will be local cache. So because pruning and the cache is all present in the same node, therefore the pruning will be very fast because it does not have to fetch data from any other node over the network. The cons for the driver mode will be memory constraint. So as you know that the driver memory is limited, maybe it's around 5 GB. So out of that 5 GB, LRU can only get maybe around 3 or 4 GB. So once that 3 or 4 GB LRU cache is filled, a lot of LRU evictions have to be done to accumulate the new cache, right? That will slow down your pruning process and thus slowing down your query. The second point will be excessive GC. So this case will happen when you have multiple concurrent queries being fired on your application, which will lead to too much data being accumulated in the driver. So driver needs to handle the cache plus all the rows that will be accumulated from your query. So that can cause to lots of GC and out of memory errors. Third con for the driver mode will be decentralized caching. So for example, if the user has multiple applications to satisfy multiple use cases, so each application may be handling a specific type of query. So each application needs to, all the applications are working on the same data store. So what will happen eventually is both the applications will cache the same store in their memory, I should say the same index metadata in their memory, leading to the other cons that we have discussed before. So the second mode is the distributed mode. To counter the bottlenecks of the driver mode, we came up with a unique caching solution called as the distributed index cache server, right? So as the name suggests, this will be a separate server or an application which is independent of the original application or the client application. So this server will allow the cache to be centralized and reused by many client applications, right? The most important point is that the cache will be distributed equally among all the executors, making this solution highly scalable. Right. One of the pros of using the index server will be pre-priming. Pre-priming is the mechanism where we preload the cache so that the query does not have to do IO. So how we do it is after each load, a async call will be fired onto the index server to load the cache before the query is executed. Okay, so coming to the cons, the only con of using the index server will be that you require additional resources because index server is deployed as a separate application. So the memory and the CPU requirements will be separate from the client application. So now let's look at the workings of the internal workings of the index server. I will start by quickly explaining the driver pruning process, and then we will go to the index server execution mode. Okay. So let's imagine this is the Spark application, the driver, and the file system. So as soon as a query is fired on the driver, during the get splits method, a request will be sent to the file system to read all the index files, right? So once the index files are read, a request is sent to the LRU cache to load all this data into memory, right? So once the index server the index server application is enabled, the driver cache becomes invalid. So you can see here there is no driver cache now. So what the Spark application will do is it will send a request to the index server driver via a RPC call, Hadoop RPC call, right? So in turn, the driver will start assigning executors to all the segments. Okay, so one segment will have a unique executor associated with it. This mapping will be maintained in the driver. This is crucial because the next time the same query comes or for the same segment, we should send the request for that segment to the particular executor which was assigned earlier. So once all this is done, tasks are created, and these load index tasks will be fired onto the executors. The executors will then start to read the file system cache in parallel, and they will create a LRU object and cache all the metadata in memory. So as you can see earlier, the cache was being kept in the driver memory. Now all the executors are keeping individual small caches. So that this way we have distributed the cache among multiple executors. So once the cache is created, a response is sent back to the driver, and on receiving the response, the driver will appropriately fire the scan task to its own executors. Now let's talk about the performance reports. So first we'll go through the performance report for secondary index. So the data size that we have chosen is of 20 GBs. The set of queries include both point queries and filter queries. So overall, we could see 3x performance upgrade for some of the queries. So as we can see from the graph, we are getting good performance benefit for query 1, 5, and 6. So the next report is for time series and MV. The data that we chose is 100 GB raw data. The queries involving granularities of hour, min, day, week, month, etc. Right. So as you can imagine, because MV is pre-computed data, we are getting very good performance of 6x. Right. So coming to the graph, you can see the 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th queries are there is a lot of performance benefit in those queries. The next is geospatial index report. So we are using 70 GB raw geospatial data, and we are querying over a region using Carbon Data's Polygon UDF. So we are getting good performance of 2x to 3x. So this concludes our presentation on the topic. So now I'll be introducing you to the Carbon Data community. Carbon Data is the first top-level Apache project that Huawei has contributed to the open source community. So Carbon Data is a high-performance data store solution which has been deployed on more than 100 enterprise production environments, among which the largest single cluster data scale reaches several trillions. So about the community, on the left, you can see the GitHub website and CV key links where you can go and read about Carbon Data. Then we have the Slack channel, the Jira issue link, and the mailing list. On the right, you can see the WeChat QR code, which you can use to join the Carbon Data group. So we'd love new people to join the Carbon Data community and make Carbon a better solution for everybody. Thank you. Now we'll be taking some questions.